won't listen to me. She'll only listen to you.
Good evening, and welcome to the City of Warrenville Public Safety and Legislative Committee, Committee of the Whole meeting. This is Monday evening, April 10th, 2017. Can I please have a roll call?
Alderman Ashower?
Here.
Alderman Berry?
Here.
Alderman Bevere?
Here.
Alderman Davalos?
Here.
Alderman Hoffman?
Here.
Alderman Widener?
Here.
Alderman Wilson?
Here.
And Alderman Goodman is excused this evening.
Yes, thank you. Now, if you'd all please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Next is citizens' comments. We have two, Vivian Lund and Kate Perkins, but Kate is going to speak during item number 5. Is that correct, Kate? Okay, thank you. So Vivian, if you'd like to go to the podium.
Can you hear me? Don't know if I can reach it. I'm Vivian Lund. And I live on Haylett, and I was mayor from 1985 to 2005. And several weeks ago when I was here, I learned that Bob Johnston, J-O-H-N-S-T-O-N, died. And he was an alderman for a number of years. Well, I think he had 2 terms while I was mayor. And I want to get in touch with his son. I've emailed the funeral home. I've talked to the library because he was president of the library board after he was finished with city council. And I can't find an address. And I think it's important. And so I'll tell you why I think it's important. Bob Johnston made the 2 most important votes, and which allowed me to vote while I was the whole 20 years I was in office. The election that just preceded that was 2 of the biggest issues were we going to allow Amoco to build an 8-story building? In order to do that, they had to have a 75-foot air easement because the plan that we had put in place before we started development had the buildings were limited to 6 stories. But they needed 8 stories so they could bring all of their employees from the loop out to work in Warrenville. And the school district was very wanted that building because that, you know, only about a third of Cantera is in District 200. So District 200 had done a lot of communicating with those of us that were involved, asking us to approve that. And the other big issue at that time was, were we going to remodel the 1917 old home school building to be a new police department station, or were we going to build a new one? And the city had done studies and determined it would cost more to rehab and upgrade the old home school than it would be to take it down and start from scratch. So we were, that was what the debate was during that election. So Bob Johnston, he kept saying, I just really can't decide how I'm going to vote on this. And I said, well, I think the best thing for you to do is to talk to the school district and also look at the plan and, you know, actually look at an 8-story building and see if you think it's going to ruin us. And so he voted the night that we voted on that. He voted yes. So it was a 4-4 tie. And so I got to cast the ballot for in favor. And so The other one was homeschool, and he got the fire department to lift him up on their big thing that has the, what do you call that, ladder truck or something. And he went up on the roof of homeschool and saw the trees growing out of the roof. And he was convinced that it was a building that had seen its best time. So he voted yes on that. And I got to vote yes and break the tie. Those were the two most important votes I made in the whole 20 years. I very seldom got to vote. So I want his son to know how important that was to our city. And so if anyone has any clue that you can give me, my phone number is 393-1186. You can try sending an email to my husband. I don't always get them. But it's Dwight Lund, all one word, at sbcglobal.net. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Vivian. Now for official and staff comments. Mayor, you have a proclamation.
Okay. I have a proclamation tonight for National Public Safety Telecommunications Week. As you know, DUCOM is our 911 provider since 1989. We've been with DUCOM. We just broke ground for a 34,000 square foot, $16 million state-of-the-art dispatch center on the county campus last week. I've been involved heavily with DUCOM for, well, the entire time I've been mayor. I've been chairman of the board for the last 8 years, so I'm very proud of this organization, very proud of the people and the work that they do for us. One of those quiet things that you take for granted until you need it. And then when you call 911 and there's a quick response, you're very grateful for the work they do. So we want to recognize that work tonight. National Public Safety Telecommunications Week. Whereas DuPage Public Safety Communications, known as DUCOM, plays a vital role in the protection of human life and property in our community. And whereas while enduring long shifts and handling frequent life and death emergencies, DUCOM telecommunicators set high standards in performing their duties in a dedicated, diligent, and compassionate manner. And whereas DUCOM telecommunicators provide a critical communication link between the residents and police, fire, and emergency medical services providers, excuse me, and whereas these individuals efficiently coordinate emergency service to ensure the health and safety of our residents, visitors, and travelers in our cities, towns, villages, districts, and on our highways 24 hours a day and 7 days a week. And whereas, Caitlin? No. Caitlin couldn't. You're from DUCOM? Well, then come on up here. Right, you're right. We knew somebody was coming. I said you didn't look like Caitlin.
No,
so.
I don't look like Caitlin.
Welcome. You are?
You. I'm Nick Toronto.
Nick?
Welcome. Nick Toronto. That rings a bell.
Sorry.
Handsome lad. Welcome, Nick. I'm about halfway through.
I'm sorry about that.
That's quite all right. You're very timely, if I can find my spot again here. 7 days a week. And whereas our public safety communications personnel daily serve the public in countless ways without due recognition by the beneficiaries of their services, now therefore I, David L. Brummel, mayor of the city of Warrenville, proclaim the week of April 9th through the 16th, 2017 as National Public Safety Telecommunications Week in the city of Warrenville, and I commend the devotion, contributions, and services of DUCOM telecommunicators. Welcome. Thank you for
Thank
coming
you so
tonight.
Much. Sorry about that.
That's for you. That's quite all right.
All right. Make sure to get the spray lift here.
Yep. You could say something if you want. Show your dad what you can do.
Oh, God. No, we always we appreciate all of our fellow municipalities that come to support us during this week. Even though we're very large, most people don't know that we truly exist. Everyone thinks when they call 911, they're getting their local agency, and unfortunately, that's just not how it is anymore. So we hope that we can bridge the gap between the citizens of each community with their local police and fire department in a safe manner, as well as a respectful manner. So, Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thanks for coming tonight.
Thank you.
All right. Clerk? Okay. Alderman? Alderman Hoffman?
I want to congratulate the mayor on his victory. I respect the will of the majority. Congratulations.
Alderman Bevere?
I'd like to thank all the residents that voted for me and to appreciate their support. And that's it. Thank you.
Okay, nothing else? And staff? Nothing. Okay, good. Now we get down to the business of the meeting. The first item is status update, the branding and regional positioning project. Senior planner Natalia Doma, Doma Vasova. Got it.
Thank you. Good evening. Just a quick background. The City Council authorized staff to move forward with the city branding and regional positioning project at the end of January this year. The goal of this project is to create city's brand and develop marketing strategy that would promote the advantages of the city of Warrenville to potential visitors, residents, and businesses that are considering investing in the city of Warrenville. So tonight, we have the city's marketing consultant, BDI Business District, Inc., together with the partners. They will present the findings and market positioning statements. These findings are based on the input received from key stakeholders, results of the Warrenville image poll, as well as input of advisory group. So the next step, just so you'd be aware, would be to define the marketing strategy and develop the actually brand image. And we anticipate to complete that project within the next 4 to 5 months. This is informational item, so no action is requested tonight, but your input and your questions are welcomed. And with that, I will let our consultant, Bridget Lane, to start the presentation.
Thank you, Natalia. As Natalia said, we're right at the conclusion of phase one, which was the market definition and positioning. And I believe all of you were given a copy of a memorandum report. So what I'm going to do is summarize that today and hopefully give you plenty of time for any questions you might have had. So this is going to continue into a marketing plan and images and have final refinements and guidelines that are going to help promote the city of Warrenville. So as Natalia said, we are going to create an authentic regional position for Warrenville and a supporting marketing strategy that clearly differentiates the city from peer communities and attracts the interest of investors and new residents. And what's important to realize is when you do marketing, you start with the one sure good thing. And that's what a lot of our effort has been, the one thing that definitely will positively differentiate Warrenville. And then as this program grows, we expect other things to happen and for the program to grow. So what you see today is what our analysis has said is the one sure good thing we're going to start with. And what the key elements of this strategy are understanding the marketplace, like what environment are you functioning in? What are the resources of Warrenville? And what are the community aspirations? And what we're looking for is linking those elements in this one market positioning. So what were the resources we uncovered? What's important here is this list is really long, and I should just mention to you, we're going to talk about this, but what was very interesting, we've done this in a number of communities as we've talked to you about. This is one of the longest lists we've ever come up with. And so the positive community strengths, what you have on the left side are strengths that may be common to other communities. So what I want to do is just spend a few minutes highlighting for you what we saw as the differentiated, because again, the purpose here is to tell the world what's different and better about Warrenville. So that comes out of what's on the right side here. And the first one is that Warrenville is a community with choices. So a lot of times we go to community and they really don't have a lot of different choices here, from the fact that you have a world-class business park, you have forest preserves, you have great housing, you just have lots of choices here. Also, totally consistent. Natalia talked about how we talked with stakeholders. We didn't go through a single interview where we weren't told about the small town character and identity, which is different. And this cherished sense of community in Warrenville. People talk to each other, they know each other, they work together. The recreational assets, the trails, the rivers, the lakes. This strategic location along the county's most expansive greenway system, we're gonna actually map that in a minute. Everyone talked about the Independence Day celebration here, so it really differentiates you from other communities. There's a very interesting festival and event space and growth potential around this building and the library in this area. You have, like I mentioned, a world-class business park. You have some new and innovative world-class businesses. And I put Amazon here, and a lot of you are thinking, yeah, but they're in Aurora. But not really, because their road's going to be built in Warrenville. And that is huge. Those of you who've been following the news and the success of a business like that, choosing Warrenville is a big deal. The access to quality talent and employment opportunities, the fact that we would like to see a little stronger connection between living and working in Warrenville, or working and then deciding to live in Warrenville. Unique businesses. Warrenville's name is partly being made by Two Brothers Brewery. So just recognizing that it's got this regional image that's really good. Ed Hoy's Art Glass and Supplies, and this proximity to the Fermi Lab. Those are the areas we've been looking at in this search for what differentiates Warrenville. At the same time, there's a few things we want to keep in mind. You have a small town image without a classic Main Street, which we think we can work with. There's barriers between the living and working centers. They don't connect naturally, Kintara and the rest of the community. This was just like a personal thing. I found your trails to be recreational rather than commuter bicycle trails. Not, I put it as a weakness here only because of the way the world's going towards commuting by bicycle. It's not as easy to do that, but you can certainly do some wonderful recreational biking here. A low market profile. Outside audiences have trouble locating the community. And then an underappreciated geographic location. In other words, and that's kind of related there. So, and this was kind of an authenticity fact check. What was interesting is, you're gonna, and you saw in the report, we like to look at a 30-minute drive time from the center of City Hall here. The reason for that is in the Chicago market, 30 minutes is a typical commute. So it means that if someone lives around this area defines the fact that they have an opportunity for over 1 million jobs within a reasonable commute of living here. But what was really interesting wasn't so much the population, but notice how Warrenville just looks like the whole area. You're not higher income or lower income. You really fit within this 30 minutes. You are kind of the typical population. So it was just kind of interesting. The same number of jobs, pretty much the same age, average income very similar, median income really, really similar, and per capita income really similar. So you are the group. So it doesn't differentiate naturally. So it's these other items that we talked about that'll be the differentiation. The other thing is, what does it mean to be a small town? So one of the things we thought about, because everyone said to us it's a small town, which led me to ask the question, well, what does that mean if we're going to market it? And what it means is there's a more balanced housing mix. So I'm not sure you can read it, but the bar to the far left is Warrenville, then it's Aurora, Naperville, West Chicago, and Wheaton, the communities that surround you. And you notice greater balance in the Warrenville one. You have lots of different prices of housing here than you do in Aurora, which is a little more stacked on the lower end, and where you get into Naperville, where it's stacked on the higher end. So someone could move here and move up. So you have this range of housing. You have distinct borders. That's one of the reasons why you feel like a small town. You enter and leave Warrenville with these distinct borders. You know, like many, like you're not really sure where you are when you go between Wheaton and Glen Ellen. Which town am I in? Or even some as you go Naperville. But Warrenville, people know when they're in Warrenville because your borders are distinct. That, I think, conveys this small town. You have friendly neighborhoods, a connected government that people know who's involved in the government. A lot of people volunteer here. It really is very much a work, live, play community. And you have this regional niche that's because of this small town character. So we felt that it really was authentic to look at this as much more of a small town for these reasons. Image poll. There's a lot more detail to this in the report we gave you, but this to me was, I think, one of the most interesting things we found. Like I said, we've done similar questions in a lot of communities, and I'm not going to name any names, but a lot of times we get called in because Warrenville is a place to live. That community is a place to live is 50% or lower. The people who live here like living here. This is excellent or above average. So average is okay because that means you're just competitive with the other communities. What people are saying who live here, 77% who answered this survey said you're better than average, and there's a reason why they are here and why they like being here. The community friendliness, again, the fact that these are high is really, really important. And the one that I'll just mention is the safety being as high as it is, being above average, is really good because that's one that's really hard to fix if you're having trouble with that. Appearance and pedestrian are a little bit worrisome. The cost of living and housing options, it may just be okay to be average there. We just asked that question to find out if it's a real competitive advantage. Probably isn't, but it's okay to be average because it means that you're not losing out to other communities. And by the way, average ended up 90%, you know, if you added average into there. So it's really a strong response to people liking living in Warrenville. This is really important in our opinion. This is kind of a graphic illustration of Warrenville being the orange borders in here, surrounded really by this green greenway and connected via the greenway. So what's outside and influencing what we can choose? The first thing, this is the brand experience of Warrenville. What we say is, although you as elected officials really understand where the municipal boundaries are, a lot of your residents don't. So they may live here, and even though you don't have that classic downtown, if somebody wants to go to a downtown and experience the traffic and some of the other problems that come with it, they can just go to Naperville, and it's really easy to do. You also have access to airports, you have the really strong Morton Arboretum, you have lots of different, you have casinos, all those things are within this 30-minute drive. So the experience of living here is very positive. Fermi Lab, it's all just, this. So this is kind of the experience that you can have here. Other opportunities. Right now, and boy, I did this a few weeks ago, but it's really popped in the news that new millennials, the real estate agents, are very excited. They're starting to buy houses. So it's really good news. The other thing that's kind of interesting is logistics is replacing retail. And you do have some space in your business park for logistics, and that's this Amazon point in the marketplace. Pop-up retail is doing very well, whether it's food trucks or adding more of a retail component to some of the festivals that communities have. The rise of multimodal commuting and telecommuting. What that means is typically today, and I have a chart that's been put together by a real estate company that questioned new home buyers. And fully 40% of them are working, even though they are employed somewhere else, are working out of their homes at least one day a week. So you have this very different kind of daily environment today that allows people to be more involved in the community as they work. So not only do you have Kentera, but you have people in their homes working. The housing value here compared to the surrounding area is a little bit better. And the other thing that's rising in the marketplace is permanent renters, people who have decided to live through the crash of the housing and said, you know, they may be empty nesters that finally recovered and they're going to buy and they're going to rent for the rest of their lives, or there's some of the new millennials that want to have a lot of flexibility. And then the other thing is, given this idea, one of the challenges we face of people not knowing exactly where Warrenville is, the use of things, tools like Google Maps, has made accessibility easier for places like this. Some of the threats, employment, moving to downtown Chicago, office real estate weakness, and a lot of that has to do with this working of homes and smaller spaces. The lack of an I-88 corridor identity for Warrenville, like you're coming down I-88 and you don't even realize you're in Warrenville. And that's partly because of these higher profile neighbors. People know them, so we have to take that on. Okay, so aspirations, and these came from the interviews and the survey. So I just wanted to first start out by saying one aspiration is to, this project needs to enhance economic development. But I wanted to make sure everybody understood we had a broad definition. Economic development embraces the creation of quality jobs and the expansion of the local tax base through the growth of companies, population, and the organizations that serve markets within and beyond the community. So sometimes I have this little graphic where it has a big bubble of retail, and it shows that is what everybody wants is economic development. But an increasing population, increasing organizations that serve the area are also really important. So what did we learn in the interview? We talked to 25 stakeholders. We really uncovered a commitment for diverse participation access for the library and Peter Aguilera. That's like you have a diverse population, a number of Latinos, and we're really working hard to integrate them into this process. This was the comment I made earlier. The internal audiences we talked to are all kind of singing from the same hymnal. They believe that Warrenville has many attractive quality of life features. There's an extraordinary sense of community, the small town character. There's an old guard, new guard present, but it's not really a problem. They both talk to each other, but they do have that. That is their outside audiences recognize the name of Warrenville, but not its location. And I said I had a kid who played football. It's because of those football teams. So they've all heard of Warrenville, but they don't know where it is. And they're generally, those audiences, though, are not aware of the city's assets. And most audiences perceive Kentera to be in Naperville. Okay, so the image poll, how do those who don't live or work in the city perceive Warrenville as a community overall? I removed the ones that said they didn't know, and then you had about two-thirds responded, somewhat desirable or very desirable. So again, the people living here think that others think of it as a desirable place. Other aspirations. How would you describe the current personality of Warrenville? And we gave these words as choices. So it's easygoing, friendly, kind of likable and quiet. What should the personality of Warrenville be to make it more appealing to families? Friendly, confident, likable, efficient. Those are some of the words that we want to convey. The reason we ask this is the image and the marketing program that we go for needs to move people in this direction to attract residents. Here's the same information for attracting businesses. And you can see how big the word efficient and confident became. So again, it's when we market, what are the messages need to create? So what did that lead to? And I'm going through this, we'll have time for questions, but what it led to, and we worked really closely with both a staff working group that Bill and Leo were on, as well as a advisory group to find that one sure good thing that we're gonna build on. And here is what, you know, Carl and I, we said, well, did you need this slide? This really shows us that what's been fun here, sometimes we do this and we have about a half as many bubbles. So these are the bubbles that feed into that positioning that we talked about before. So we have an opportunity here to build on a lot of great opportunities, aspirations, and resources. So I'm just going to read this, but this would be a positioning statement, and it's that the operative word for Warrenville is natural. Warrenville is a natural destination for active recreational enthusiasts and the businesses that support them because of its location at the nexus of DuPage County's most expansive greenway system comprised of forest preserves, trails, rivers, and lakes. Warrenville is a natural location for companies seeking to attract talent and grow their businesses because of its access to the I-88 Illinois Technology and Research Corridor, its range of office, industrial space options, and its close proximity to world-class quality of life amenities. Finally, Warrenville is a natural location to live and raise a family because of its outstanding schools, variety of residential living options, proximity to quality jobs, abundant recreational amenities, small town character, and above all, its cherished sense of community. And the summary of that, which what's important at this point to understand, this is going to guide our marketing plan and the image, but this doesn't appear. This isn't like a logo or something like that. But the summary is that Warrenville will be naturally recognized for its abundant recreational amenities, premier DuPage County location for businesses, and range of residential living options. So that's how we pulled all together the description for this. And that would guide the establishing of the marketing plan. So, questions? And I should introduce Carl Wolt, who's working with me on the project. He will be very much responsible for the design and image, as well as been really key to the positioning. And Cindy Bodie, who does the marketing plan and media recommendations. So we're here, all of us, to answer any questions.
Alderman Davalos.
Thank you. Yes, this was interesting. I tried to be as much a part of it as I could because I just thought it was interesting. The first comment I want to make is to thank you for tying it to our strategic and economic plan, because I think it really is kind of an outflow of that.
Absolutely.
And it certainly justifies what we're trying to do, because that is one of our biggest things we're concentrating on these days. And so although we may have thought that, I'm glad that you stated it in there. The word natural I thought was very intriguing. I think I certainly agree with almost all the data that's up there, but wouldn't have picked that word, but really like it. So I think that's kind of it's a refreshing way to look at that. So, also, could you explain... one of the slides is the one that says, one sure good thing, positioning. Was that an example on the sheet? It had a picture with a red circle around it. Could you just explain that slide, what that means?
I don't know, Carl, if you want to take over a little bit. It's really a process issue. A lot of times, we don't want you to get mired in trying to accomplish too much. So what we're saying is you're going to start with the one good thing, and it's the word naturally. And we don't know exactly where we're going at this point. We're going to continue to work closely with the staff and the two aldermen working group that we have, and with the advisory committee. But that's it. Oh, I'm sorry. I left the microphone. I apologize.
Thank you.
I got my instructions. But that it's really not what's specifically there, but that is the point, that in the future, marketing programs grow, and what we want to say is you got to start with the one good thing. It doesn't mean you're going to ignore the other things that are great here, but you're going to be focused. Yeah, you got to get to the microphone.
No, I think Bridget explained it pretty well. And the way we kind of conceive this is it's a 1 to 3 to 5 year, you really kind of hit hard. Most communities don't have a $6 billion marketing budget like Procter & Gamble. So, you know, the more you focus your resources on trying to create, and people are bombarded by this all the time, so trying to get a simple message out there that resonates in the marketplace is actually pretty challenging. But the first thing to do is make sure that we have the position oriented. I always think the positioning is as important as the creative part. So I think there's a lot we can do with that concept of natural choice.
Okay, can I make a recommendation? If you really need to pick up the microphone. Okay. Christina, can you actually? Oh, okay, great, thank you. Yeah, and hold the microphone up so we don't want anybody that isn't here to miss what we're saying.
Great, thank you.
So my last question is on the final statement, the brand promise. It occurred to me, one of the things that was commented on a lot was the small town nature, the people know each other, it's less chaotic than some of the surrounding communities, that sort of thing. And yet, that isn't in that statement. So I'm thinking, and maybe you can just explain this, that it goes back to this one thing at a time deal. You don't want to have maybe a lot of things going on, but also, I suppose a small town feel, is that not attractive to businesses? It would be attractive to residents, but perhaps that's not a plus in the business community.
One of the things when we've been working in communities, we hear a lot of the same things in Chicago. Great access, we have great parks, we have great schools, and the sense of community is definitely one of them. And so we always put it in the category of, you know, it's a great asset, but it's not necessarily a differentiating asset. And it's kind of right in between that for you guys. We put it in the differentiating assets, and I think we can show that via imagery, images of families, images of people going to events, having a good time. But, this statement, as does the positioning statement, tend to evolve, continue to evolve until the end of the project, because we get different ideas from people, and they go, oh, that's a better word. So we'll think about that.
Yeah, because we are never going to expand. We're expanded geographically as much as we're going to expand. We don't have farm fields that are going to be bought up and turned into housing. But that's actually what a lot of people like.
Mm-hmm.
And so, just interesting. But anyway, thank you so much. This is going to be a fascinating project, and I just am very excited about what you've done so far. So thank you.
Thank you.
Mayor, you had a comment?
Yeah, I like the natural designation also. I think it has a lot of potential, and it's different than what you hear out there, which is kind of nice. Can you go back one slide? I had one question on the last. At the very, very end there, you list some very nice qualities of the city. One of the things that was mentioned several times in your presentation was how safe a community we are, but that's absent from that. Is that an oversight, or just you didn't think it was essential?
It is expected, and probably because it's expected from people. You do better than a lot of communities. And like Carl said, this is evolving, and we need to make sure we convey that. And we can think about whether there's a way to add it, but it's one of the basics that people expect out of their community, and that's why I said, if you can't deliver this, you're in real trouble, because it's hard to make
an image.
But if
you deliver it particularly well, it seems like something that should be highlighted, because if you're looking for a place to settle down with your family,
totally.
I would think that safety, you know, if you're among the safest communities in Illinois, which we have been designated several times.
That's a good point.
Something maybe that should be highlighted, that not only are we safe, we're especially safe.
Okay, great. Like I said, Carl said, well, this is evolving, and that's something we can add pretty easily.
Any other comments or questions? Okay. Well, thank you very much. That was a very interesting presentation. Thank you. Okay, that was a informational only. So we'll go on to number two, the bike rodeo partial street closure request. Ginny. Planner Ginny McIntosh.
So GPAC has a few items for you tonight, the first of which is a request for a partial street closure. As you may know, the annual bike rodeo is coming up in May. We're set for May 20th from 9 a.m. until noon. And as we have done in years past, we are requesting a partial street closure of Stafford Place. We would leave the roundabout open. However, there would be barricades up from there until the library. Just, we've had issues in the past with people parking in the parking lot, which makes it very interesting when you're trying to set up for an event. So that is our request. And there's a street closure map attached if you have it with you.
Okay. Alderman Widener?
Yeah, we've done this for years. It makes the event absolutely safe for all the participants. And with that, I'd make a motion to recommend City Council authorize the partial closure of Stafford Place for the annual bike rodeo event as stated in the April 4th, 2017 memo from Planner GIS Technician and BPAC Staff Lias and McIntosh.
Second. A motion by Alderman Widener and a second by Alderman Davalos. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, motion passes. Number three, solicitations for bike rodeo event. Again, Planner McIntosh.
Yep, so as per usual and as in years past, we are requesting to solicit local businesses for donated items for use as prizes or monetary donations for purchasing drawing prizes for the annual bike rodeo. Typically in years past, we've contacted Target, who has worked with us on obtaining discounted bikes. Sometimes they've helped with gift cards, that kind of thing, to make it more affordable and be able to purchase more bikes for the event for people who attend. Also, Dairy Queen has typically provided assistance in the way of ice cream bars, ice cream cones. So those are given out at the event as well.
Thank you. Comments, questions? Alderman Widener?
Again, this has been going on for many years with thanks to the Bike and Pedestrian Advisory Commissioner, Jerry Sugru, who's in the audience tonight. Jerry does a great job seeking out the best deals possible on the city's behalf for the bikes that are offered at the rodeo. So thank you to Jerry, and with that, I make a motion to recommend the City Council approve the request to solicit bids for the 12th annual bike rodeo event on May 20th, 2017.
Second.
There will be a motion by Alderman Widener and a second by Alderman Davalos. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, motion passes.
Thank you.
Number four, solicitations for local National Night Out Against Crime. Chief Toronto.
Thank you, Chairman. As we have in years past, this is a request to solicit monetary and in-kind donations from our business partners within the community to put on our National Night Out event, which we do with a fairly modest budget. It's the wonderful participation, again, of our business community that makes this such a successful event and one of the highlight events that we hold in the city every year. Attached in the backup material is a draft letter and also a list of the businesses that we would be contacting, and the staff would recommend this action.
Thank you. Any comments or questions? Alderman Widener?
Again, I've seen this event grow from a small-scale event into something that's a huge success, something the citizens really enjoy and gets quite a large attendance. And with that, I make a motion to recommend the City Council approve the request to solicit donations for the August 1st, 2017 National Night Out event.
Second.
Motion by Alderman Widener, second by Alderman Davalos. Alderman Davalos, you had a question?
Yes, I just want to make a comment. This is one of my very favorite things to go to. And I didn't go for years and years because I didn't even know what was going on. And then I went. And I will never forget. And I wish, I know we can't do this, Chief. We don't have our canine unit anymore. But I wish we could borrow a canine unit, because I was just so happy or smiling. The first year I went, here's the canine officer and the dog just wandering all over, and this long line of children, like it looked like 100 kids, were following these two all over Cerny Park, and they were just having a ball. So I know we may not be able to do it, but it is a really fun event for the whole family. And we turn out more people for the size of our community than some of these larger cities. And it's just a really cool event. So I'm just glad to second this motion.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, motion passes. Number five, BPAC recommendations to address pedestrian safety. We had Kate Perkins. Kate, would you like to make your comments now?
Hi, my name is Kate Perkins. I live at 3 South 111 Glen Drive North here in the city. I am the chairperson of the city's Bicyclist and Pedestrian Advisory Commission. Our charter on the BPAC is to advocate and be concerned with pedestrian and bicyclist issues here in the city. Several weeks ago, Jerry Segrew, one of our other commissioners who's here tonight, and I spoke to the council about our concerns about this safety at the intersection of Highway 59, Continental, and Meadow. At that time, since we spoke to you, there's been an additional accident. About 2 weeks ago, a pedestrian was struck in broad daylight as she legally crossed at that intersection. So it's even more urgent than it was when we were here before. At that time, it was suggested that the BPAC write a memo to the city council asking for action about that intersection, and that is the memo that is in your packet tonight. What we are asking is that the city council direct or request IDOT to study this intersection. We include a list of suggested ways to improve that intersection that seem to make sense to us as pedestrians and bicyclists, but we are not traffic engineers, so the true request is to ask IDOT to study this intersection and come up with ways to make it safer. I should say that, you know, like looking at it, it seems to me there's been 3 pedestrian car accidents at that intersection in the last 14 or 15 months. The chief of police could speak to this better than I am sure, but that seems to make it one of the most dangerous intersections in this whole town. I'd also like to say, kind of in closing, is that when you hear about accidents, we as people have a natural tendency to say, you know, that wouldn't happen to me. I wouldn't cross that intersection in the dark. I wouldn't do this. I wouldn't do that. But I'm here not only to advocate for pedestrians at this point, but also for motorists. I could say as a pedestrian, I might never cross that road in the dark, but I can't say as a driver that I would never drive on that road in the dark. And I think I speak for a lot of people that if I hit a pedestrian, whether it was a pedestrian's fault or not, I would never forget that. It would take me a long time to get over that. And so on behalf of pedestrians and cyclists and motorists in the city of Warrenville, I'm asking the council to ask IDOT to study that intersection and come up with suggested improvements. Thank you.
Thank you, Kate. Planner McIntosh, mm-hmm. are you doing the presentation on this?
Yeah, I think okay. That summarizes all the information, so.
Oh, okay, very good. Do we have any comments or questions? Alderman Davalos.
Yes, I would just like to thank the Bicycle and Pedestrian Commission for working on this so quickly. There's been a lot of public comments. There's been a lot of discussion about this, but thank you very much, because now it's to IDOT, and there's your holdup. But we got it. This is great. And I especially like the part about lights, because I think a lot of these accidents, as would be normal, are at night. Not all, but a lot are. And so, you know, we need a safe crossing, because there's a whole community over there that would like to frequent the other side or whatever, and I just think we have to find a way to do this. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Alderman Wilson.
I was going to say, particularly the lighting down there, that's a very dark intersection relative to all the other intersections that we have. And I was through there just the other night, and I think there's only one street light at that intersection. And there's a lot of people that walk back and forth. You got that Dairy Queen right there, and you got all the businesses on this side. So particularly the lighting struck out in my mind as something that really needs to be improved at that intersection. So thank you for bringing this up, and hope that we can do something about it through the state.
Well, thank you. The lighting certainly is a concern. I think the speed limit is a concern too, but again, that's a matter for IDOT to study. Thank you.
Chief Toronto, did you have a comment?
No, I think it was, what was brought up by the commission was well stated, that it does excuse me, present some challenges as it is a problematic intersection, because it is dark, especially if you go south of that location. It's heavily shaded on both sides of the street. I think when you add in conditions of either snow or rainfall, that it's easy to overdrive your headlights and potentially have an accident there. But I did do just a brief cursory study, because West Chicago was cited in there, and I did go and look at that myself. And the 35 mile an hour speed limit commences just north of Washington, where there's a traffic light on Route 59. Now, I think it's good information for the committee and also BPAC to understand that whenever you have a speed limit sign posted, you cannot enforce within 500 feet of that sign. You have to give at least a 500-foot zone before the police can actually enforce that speed limit. Okay, but in West Chicago, that goes from Washington to Brown Street, which is approximately 0.6 tenths of a mile. I think the other important thing that may be a little bit of a differentiation, in that area in West Chicago, there were 17 curb cuts for points of ingress and egress from strip malls, fast food restaurants, and what have you. Immediately south of there, Brown Street, after the 6/10 of a mile, it resumes to 45 miles per hour, as it is to the north of Washington. As far as what we've had here at the Continental and Route 59, excuse me, these accidents took place in a period of time of 2013, May of 2013, to April of 2017. So we have almost four full years. There were six accidents there. It was correctly stated the most recent one took place approximately 2 weeks ago. Of those six accidents, there were three fatalities. Four of the accidents took place at the intersection. Two of the fatal incidents, though, and I think this is important to note, they took place approximately 400 to 600 feet. Two of the accidents, one involving a fatality, took place approximately 400 to 600 feet north of that intersection, where it's extremely dark and you have absolutely no traffic control there whatsoever. So I think when you talk about lighting, and Administrator Coakley has brought this up, it's not just a matter of lighting an intersection, it's having transitional lighting north of and south of the intersection, which would in fact make that more helpful. So those are all the comments I had. Thank you.
Thank you. Alderman Widener?
Yeah, I certainly hope IDOT will take a close look at this, and it would be, I think, great for the community or someone to come up with a full set of possible options and potential improvements. And, you know, I had the opportunity to talk to the owner of the Dairy Queen, and he was talking about the number of times he's seen, you know, kids try and cross that intersection and have close calls, because it is, you know, close to a business that is frequented by a lot of young children, and then you've got a park which is also frequented by a lot of young children, and you've got a school in close proximity that is also frequented by nearly all young children. So I think it would be great, you know, to address that as well as the speed limit. And I'm just strongly in favor of this, and again, I commend the BPAC for working on this and developing these recommendations that'll be forwarded on to IDOT. And With that, I make a motion to recommend the City Council direct city staff to work with Illinois Department of Transportation to investigate and research potential alternatives to increase overall pedestrian safety at the converging intersection of Route 59, Continental Drive, and Meadow Avenue, as outlined in the April 4th, 2017 memorandum from BPAC Chair Perkins and Planner GIS Technician McIntosh.
Second.
We have a motion by Alderman Widener and a second by Alderman Davalos. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, motion passes. On to number six. Illinois Route 56 Streetscape Construction Agreement. Senior Engineer Hocking.
Thank you very much. As all of you know, this project has been a long time coming. Alderman Goodman and Barry have been on the work group, I believe, for about 10 years, has it been?
Close
to 10 years.
Feels like a lot longer.
As I went through all of the past agendas and minutes, it was kind of amazing. But it's finally on its last hurrah right now. In 2010, the city received approximately $1 million in ITEP grant funds for this project, which was a 75-25 cost share agreement. Most recently, in July of 2016, the City Council accepted the work group's recommendation to go ahead with the final design. In January of 2017, this past year, a couple months ago, the city's consultant prepared final bid documents. Specifications and a cost estimate to be submitted and submitted it to IDOT for pre-final review. At this time, the cost estimate that was prepared showed an increase of cost of about 35%. This was due to just general rising costs of construction, IDOT requirements for certain items like mobilization, special waste management, traffic control that wasn't included in previous cost estimates, some additional items like lighting at the corner intersection of Rockwell and on the south side of 56, as well as the increase in cost of masonry and columns due to some additional structural requirements that are going to be required for those four columns on near the bridge. So the work group met in March to go over these items, or to go over the project and see what items could be minimized to align more along the lines of what was endorsed by the City Council back in 2016. These items are listed in the memo. Some of them that were removed were some areas of pedestrian lighting, a couple of wayfinding signs per IDOT comments. The irrigation system was decided that it wasn't necessary due to the native types of plantings that are going to be planted, and they wouldn't require intense irrigation. There was an addition of a beacon light, elimination of some decorative bases, and some minimizing of landscape plantings at Route 59 and Route 56. So the final engineering costs are estimated to be around $1.1 million with a $306,000 city share. $315,000 is actually currently allocated in the FY18 budget that was is to be approved. And so we have enough funds in there to complete this project. Estimating annual costs, we estimate about $26,000 for the CMRP. This is pretty much in line with what was presented previously. About $4,500 annually for landscaping, $2,500 for electricity, and then a $367 annual ComEd lease. This is for the monument sign that's going to be placed on Winfield Road on the west side, just south of 56. It's going to be a gateway, essentially, sign. It's made of masonry, and it's actually located on ComEd property. There is no due dot right away to place this sign. So we are going to require ComEd is requiring a lease for that area that we would be placing that sign, and that is their that is the negotiated amount that we had with them. So in the packet and amongst the various sub items in the agenda, sub item B is the actual IDOT local agency agreement. This is where it designates the amount that the local community is going to pay, which is the 306 $1,601 amount. The next item is sub-item C, which is the Construction Engineering Services Agreement. For this, we recommended ERA Hitchcock Design Group perform the construction services for this project. They performed the design for the phase one and the phase two. They're intimately familiar with the project, and they've done construction engineering for us in the past that we've been pleased with. And then finally, sub-item number D is the local public agency resident construction supervisor in charge form, and that's just another form that IDOT requires to show who from the consultant is going to be the supervisor for the construction engineering, and so that just needs to get signed by the community. All of these items, including resubmit of the plans, the specs, need to be submitted back to IDOT by May 8th, so that's why I'm here requesting for the approval of these agreements. And then the last couple of items that won't be presented now but will be presented at the next committee meeting is the ComEd lease agreement. They've been kind of slow to getting us that agreement, but I should have it by to present it at the next committee, as well as IDOT's requiring, obviously, a maintenance agreement similar to what was done for the Route 56 expansion project. IDOT wants to make sure that we will be maintaining the items as per this the plans in this project. So with that.
Thank you.
Any questions?
Alderman Davalos.
Thank you. Just a couple questions. Is the digital sign still going to be there at Butterfield and Batavia?
Yes.
Okay, that's all still there.
Yes, it's a scrolling in the plans. It kind of shows a little mock-up of it's going to be three lines going across, scrolling, maintained via electronically, not hardwired, but over some type of wireless communication, so someone within City Hall could be, you know, putting up the sign messages on a...
Which seems timely, since I guess a lot of people don't know our boundaries or don't know where we are. So
right, so there's going to be...
This is a good thing.
Mm-hmm, there's going to be a monument sign, obviously, on Winfield. There's going to be one at that corner, and then on the west end of the city on Route 56,
okay.
When you come under the bridge.
Mm-hmm. My personal concern is the beacon light at Rockwell was taken out.
No, that was actually put back in.
Oh, it
that
was
actually
back in?
Placed in, yeah.
Oh, I missed
the
that
addition
part.
Of
oh,
the
good.
Beacon light at Rockwell, yes. That was
that
obviously
is my
a big safety.
Nemesis right now.
That was a big
I
safety.
I never go there at night. I'm always afraid I'm mm-hmm. not going to make the thing.
Yep.
Elimination of all colored concrete repair. That must be out there at the main intersection.
Correct.
Will we just do that in-house, or...?
We figured that we could easily do that in-house
okay.
Through a different type of contract or have our public works try and figure something
yeah.
else out
okay.
to make that
okay.
less slippery.
Thank you.
Any other comments or questions? Alderman Wilson?
Just about the lighting.
Mm-hmm.
There's lighting on the south side of... Am I looking at the present with this one here? Does it still have lighting along the prairie path?
There's lighting along the prairie path up to a certain point. The remainder of the lighting on the south side of 56, that the prairie path lighting will be part of the future trailhead project.
Mm-hmm.
That
so
was
we took
my
that out.
This,
yeah.
This is incorporate in, it's not
right.
in addition to...
Right, we took that
to
out because we knew that that was going to be a part of that project, and the grant money that we asked for part of that project included the pedestrian lighting along the prairie path. There will be pedestrian lighting on the north side
mm-hmm.
Of 56 west of Batavia all the way to Williams.
Yeah, I saw that they've eliminated like 19 of those on the north side of 56.
Right, when we were looking for some cost savings, the work group agreed that pedestrian lighting west of Williams wasn't really, didn't seem as necessary as it did at this, at east of Williams.
Good. Yeah, because originally there were 56 lights,
yeah,
I think, from Batavia to Patterson, and I was delighted to see it reduced some by those 19.
Correct.
But anyway,
yeah.
Okay, just those two lighting situations.
Yeah, all the street lighting remains, so there's all the lighting at Batavia and 56, and then the transitional lighting along Batavia as well as along 56.
Okay, fine. Thank you very much.
Mayor?
If everything goes well, when can we expect to see some of these things actually appear in real life?
We anticipate, as long as everything goes okay with IDOT, being on the August 4th IDOT letting, so that's when it goes out to bid, and construction usually occurs within, about 45 days, so about a month and a half, you should start seeing some of these items being put in the ground. Hopefully, you know, it depends on weather, obviously, but I mean, we'd have to wait to see what the actual contractor comes up with a schedule, but we would see some of these items this year, obviously.
A lot of the items this year?
We hope so.
It's pretty exciting stuff, so that's why I'm asking. Mm-hmm. I think it's really going to make a big difference for people coming through town in terms of our identity.
Right.
In a very, very positive way. So it's very exciting things. Thank you for your work on this.
There was definitely a lot of ties to the presentation today. There's going to be trailhead signs, a trailhead map, wayfinding signs, a bike rack, a really cool looking bike rack. It looks like a bike. So it's a lot of interesting things that, you know, people would want to come to Warrenville and see and use the bike path and see what we have to offer.
Good. Well, thank you. This is good stuff.
Yes, one of the things that we did eliminate also was some of the landscaping down at Route 59 and Butterfield Road, because we felt that with the TIF 4 coming forward, that those areas were probably going to be developed in the upcoming future, hopefully within a very short period of time. And why would we want to put money into that and then have it re-torn up again? So that was one of the cost savings things, and I thank the group for thinking of that, because we just don't need to spend the money on that kind of thing at this time. So I just want to thank the Route 56 Streetscape Work Group for all the years that they have put into this, because many of the people who were on it 10 years ago are still on it now. And they've worked very hard, and it's going to be very exciting to see the final conclusion to this. And I think that the people of Warrenville will also really be amazed at what they will see that's coming, because I think a lot of them think that this is it, and they don't have any idea as to the things that are going to go forward. It's going to be so, it's going to make the city look so beautiful when they drive down Butterfield Road.
Especially coming over the bridge.
The bridge is going to be.
There's going to be two or four columns, say Warrenville, on the on the edges, so it'll be kind of be like another gateway into the city center.
Mayor?
One last comment, just to highlight, this is typical of many of the projects that we do. We leverage outside money to get huge value for our investment, so we're getting over $1 million worth of improvements for about $300,000. This is what we do in this town. We do our best to make sure that we spend our money wisely, and we find outside money to help us do these good things. So I just want to highlight that.
Thank you. Okay, item A was informational only. Item B, we would need a motion. Alderman Wilson?
I'd like to make a motion that the recommend the City Council approve the agreement and authorize Mayor Brummel to execute the local agency agreement for federal participation in an amount not to exceed $1,133,928 that will be cost shared with $827,327 of ITEP funds and $306,601 by the City of Warrenville.
Second.
There's a motion by Alderman Wilson and a second by Alderman Davalos. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Motion passes for item B. Now on to item C, the construction engineering services agreement. You need a motion for that. Alderman Wilson.
I'd like to make a motion to recommend the City Council approve the agreement and authorize Mayor Brummel to execute the construction engineering services agreement for federal participation and authorize senior civil engineer Hotchin to execute ERA's construction engineering proposal in an amount not to exceed $100,259 that will be cost shared with $69,236 of ITEP funds and $31,023 by the City of Warrenville.
Second.
A motion by Alderman Wilson and a second by Alderman Davalos. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. And finally, D, local public agency resident construction requirement IDOT form. A motion? Alderman Wilson.
I'd like to make a motion to recommend the City Council approve the agreement and authorize Senior Civil Engineer Hawkins to execute the local public agency resident construction supervisor slash in response charge form attached as Exhibit E on behalf of the City of Warrenville.
Second.
Motion by Alderman Wilson, a second by Alderman Davalos. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, motion passes. Thank you. Okay, on to number 7. Backflow prevention program agreement. It's Phil. You know, I can't read the signs. Okay, forget the titles. Okay. Phil.
Thank you. You may recall last month's Community Development Committee of the Whole meeting, I originally presented this item, and it's for some code amendments to support the city's required cross-connection control program. And there's also a contract with a private company to help the city administer this program. At that meeting, Alderman Bevere recommended a consultant or a company that's local for us to consider, and council directed staff to receive a proposal from that company and then come back to a future meeting to bring this back. So we did receive a proposal from that company compared to the proposal we were previously recommending as well as the other one we had received. So we received a total of 3 proposals. And we're still recommending Aqua Backflow. They're the ones that have the most relevant experience in this area of backflow prevention devices and also the cheapest for the city and its customers. One thing I'd like to add is at the last meeting, afterwards I spoke with a representative from Aqua Backflow, Tom Strowski, who's actually here tonight too. And he agreed to modify his proposal or offered to modify his proposal so there would be no cost to the city at all. So similar to the Bricer proposal where there was a zero cost to the city and the only cost involved is to the inspectors who inspect these devices and submit the reports online. Aqua Backflow's, I think, charged $9.95 per inspection form, and Bricer was at $12, and the third company we looked at was, I think, at $12.95 per. So the combination of experience and cost was why we're recommending Aqua Backflow. So we're recommending some code changes that help support this program as well as a contract with Aqua Backflow.
Okay. Thank you, Deputy Public Works Director Kukler. Thank you. Comments, questions? Alderman Bevere.
Yeah, I thought we were going to kind of see a side-by-side comparison, and I just see one contract in here. That's what I was under impression. And I didn't see nothing on the agenda, and I touched base with Bricer, and basically, you know, he's a, you know, a company in our city, and we should give him every chance he can. And he said he didn't get any return phone calls, and I think he'd meet with him face-to-face to discuss how he, you know, can compare these two and, you know, give him a chance to, you know, work with us. And I just want to get the best deal and try to keep business in town. And, you know, we got to call people back. And
I did respond to him. As far as side-by-side comparison, the price per inspection report is still $9.95 for Aqua Backflow. It's still $12 for Bricer. There's no cost to the city with either one of them. I
think he brought up points that, you know, like with the mailings going out, and if there's several, and I don't know, I just would like to see, compare to make sure everything's equal.
They're offering the same service. The mailings that he's referring to, the IEP required survey, which is every two or three years, Aqua Backflow is going to provide that language for the city, and we're going to include in our water bills, which go out every other month. So there's no cost to the city.
I think
that
we should at least give a business in town to sit down and at least talk with them. I
checked the references. They've been at this for maybe a year and a half compared to Aqua Backflow's
more experience in this area.
I just, the guy got no time of the day from us, and I don't like that. And I'm not for this because, you know, you should sit down and talk to him. He's in our town. That's all I got to say.
Alderman Ashower.
I thought the instruction when we talked about it last time was to give us a comparable. I mean, it's not unusual for us to get comparables on everything. And when I read the contract, and I'm not a lawyer, but it seems like there's things that we can be optioned that we will be responsible for. And I don't know if that's in this contract or in everybody's proposal. And I would have thought that the goal would be to try and get the city the least amount of responsibility with the best impact with having the customers that actually need this service pay for it without the city having to go after people that change addresses, move away, things like that. There's just some things here that I would have liked to see in an exact comparison. I mean, I know that there's been comments as long as I've been on the council that we need to give Warrenville businesses an opportunity to represent themselves to the city in a way that is fair and appropriate. And I just don't feel like that's happened. I don't see anything from them.
City Administrator Coakley.
Thank you. My recollection of the direction of the council was that staff would go back and consider the alternate proposals. I don't recall that staff was to bring forward the alternate for the council to consider. If we misunderstood that, the direction that I recall from the minutes from the meeting was, as the alderman had asked, the council voted to, or at least there was a concurrence, that we would go back and look at the different proposals. And my understanding from the materials and speaking with Phil, that he's done that, there's actually three proposals that were considered. One was the local company, one was Aqua Backflow, and I don't recall the name of the other that were all reviewed. And the one that met the needs the department identified was still the same company based on their experience and based on how we're gonna do that. Now again, Phil is the one that's answering the questions, the detail, because he's done the research on it. But I don't recall the direction to bring back those side-by-side comparisons or bring you all back the different contracts to consider. It was for staff to go back and look at the local company to see if they were qualified. Certainly we have direction in our purchasing policies in our practices to consider local companies. We do a lot of purchasing locally through many things where we use Target as a vendor for certain things. We use Family Foods for others, Ace Hardware, whenever we can, on and on through local companies that are in our industrial park. So that is, you are correct, that is our policy and our practice. When even if all things aren't equal, it's cheaper to sometimes and better practice to drive to Ace Hardware and get something rather than drive all the way to Menards to save $2 on something. We waste more personnel time, and we also are not supporting a local business in that regard. So I don't want to make it sound like we don't support local businesses. We certainly do. We spend tens of thousands of dollars locally at least each year.
Alderman Widener, you had a question? A comment?
There are three proposals, right?
Correct.
And you evaluated each one of them component by component to determine the low bid?
Yeah, utility division, lead supervisor Satter compared the first two before we received the local companies. I compared the Aquas with the local companies with Pricers.
And in your professional judgment, you found Aqua, the group you're recommending to be the lowest responsible bidder?
It's not a bid, but yes, the mm-hmm. company I'm recommending.
And we're under some requirements here to make sure that we award this project to the lowest responsible bidder?
No, this isn't a bid. I mean, it would be similar to the engineering contracts. We could choose to pay more if we wanted to. We try to pay less where we can. And this isn't a situation where it's an engineering firm where we're going to have a road that's poorly designed because we go with somebody that's cutting corners or a sewer or water system that might not be designed as well or looked after as well. This is collecting data, reports, and filing them and tracking that for the city.
In your mind, what's the difference of the services that are
offered? Bricer's been at this, as far as I can tell, with checking their references a year to 2 years in this specific area. They have a great deal of experience with fire, working with fire districts, as well as tracking elevator reports and things like that. But as far as the actual backflow prevention, they've been at it a more limited amount of time than Aqua.
Okay, thank you.
How long has Aqua been in doing this?
There's a representative here. He can give you a little bit more information about his company.
Like to go to the microphone?
I'm Tom with Aqua Backflow. We've been existing.
You need to pick up the microphone.
I'm Tom with Aqua Backflow, and we've been in existence for over 10 years.
Okay, so what we're asking you to do, you've been doing this for 10 years.
Yeah, and we're all licensed plumbers and certified cross-connection or backflow technicians versus the other company that you're looking into is doesn't have the background or the knowledge. They're more of a tracking-specific firm, whereas we are a backflow firm, basically of field technicians. So if one of your water customers calls and has an inquiry, at least we know how to answer it on behalf of the city.
Okay, other questions? Alderman Ashower, you had your hand.
This question is for, do the other people that have offered their services have a cancellation or termination fee?
I would have to check and see that. I honestly don't know if they do or not. I know Aqua does.
There's a $1,500 termination fee if we cancel the contract.
Within the first 12 months. That's just to help recoup some of our costs of implementing and creating your program.
And I have to apologize. I don't mean to seem adversarial.
No, I understand.
My frustration is that I don't feel like I got the information we were looking for, and maybe I wasn't clear when we asked for it.
Sure.
And you can certainly understand where you live that it is about supporting our local business, which happens to be in our ward.
Right.
Alderman Bevere?
Yeah, you guys are out of DuPage County, right?
Kane.
Kane, yeah. So you have licensed DuPage County plumbers to do these inspections?
For site inspections, yeah. Well, the majority of what we're doing is tracking. So we're state of Illinois licensed plumbers. And so the tracking aspect is the majority of what we do. If we get into site inspections and that, which we talked about maybe sometime down the road, there will be state of Illinois licensed plumbers doing the inspections.
Okay. This one's for Phil. I just, if the guy wanted to talk to you on the phone and maybe come in, maybe there's some other things, he took the fee off, and I don't know, maybe he's willing to work with you. That's the only thing I didn't see in here. And he made a statement that he wants to talk to you, and he can't. So I think we owe it to at least talk to the guy. And I asked for apples to apples when I talked about it last week, and all I see is one apple here. So, it probably wasn't in the motion I made, but that was mentioned.
Okay, Alderman Wilson?
Yeah, looking at the background, the information that we got here from you, number F7.
Yes.
On page 2, it says there that when the required inspections are done, that they will file a report online for a fee of $9.95. That is correct?
That's correct.
And you also say the fee is slightly lower than the other two companies considered, $12.95 and $12. Those figures are correct?
That's correct.
So $9.95 is less than $12. And
yes,
You've looked at the relevance of their experience, and it's a lower cost?
Yes.
Okay, I just don't see why we're debating the difference. This is paid for by the individual who has this flow device, correct?
That's correct.
Not us.
Correct.
So we're looking out for the individual who has this device.
Yes.
So whether he pays $12.95 or $9.95.
That's correct.
Seems to me that I'm in favor of, if all things being equal, and you stated in your presentation that relevant experience and lowest cost for these three companies. So based upon that, I'd like to make a recommend that the City Council pass an ordinance adopting changes to Section 7-4A-18 of the City Code and approve a three-year contract with Aqua Backflow, Inc. of Elgin to administer the city's cross-connection control program at no cost to the city.
Second.
Motion by Alderman Wilson, a second by Alderman Davalos. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Nay.
I'm sorry. I apologize.
My question would be, there's the $10 a month charge. What other responsibility does the city have?
I mean, it's $9.95 per test submission, which is done once a year. So it's $9.95 per year for the test to be submitted to us. As far as your additional costs, there are no additional costs unless the city decides to have us do physical site inspections to go to commercial properties or whatever to do an inspection to see if there's any cross connections or any potential cross connections that could contaminate your water supply.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Alderman Hoffman.
Does a private company have any obligation that they have to use you, or is if we're making this ordinance, is it saying that everybody in town has to use your service, or can they go outside to choose their own services?
We don't do backflow testing service or installation, and we don't want that conflict of interest. So we're strictly a consultant for the city, managing your data for you, providing customer or lists of testers for your water customers. They can just go online onto our website or contact us and say, who should I call to test it? We also include that information on the letters when we send out a test due notification. Last year, you had ABC Plumbing test your backflow preventer for you. Here's their phone number if you want to call them again. But you know, we don't endorse anybody. It's strictly, you know, whoever your water customer wants to use. We don't get involved with that.
So basically, all you're doing is just making sure that people are complying with the state test.
Correct. With the testing, the installations, the repairs, all that.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Okay, we had a vote, and it appeared that the motion passed. And that's it. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Number eight, FY 2018 budget discussion. Administrator Coakley.
Thank you. This is the second to last meeting where there is still time to make comments, ask questions, get more information about the budget. It's on the agenda tonight. We've had a number of meetings and discussions about the budget, including the one on Saturday morning, March 18th. We will still have on the agenda for next Monday's City Council meeting will be both an opportunity to discuss it, but it will be the motion to actually adopt the budget ordinance and pass that budget. So this would be a really good time if people have questions, or if someone thinks of something on the way home tonight or 2 a.m. when you wake up thinking about city business anytime during the day, contact Kevin Dahlstrand, our finance director, or me. We can look at something, get you a quick answer back. But you will see the final ordinance for adopting the fiscal year 2018 budget on next Monday night's meeting. If there's any questions, I'll be happy to try to answer them or get the information back to you.
That's the end for the business of the meeting. We have miscellaneous commendations. We had a letter from or an email from a happy citizen who drove through Warrenville and was assisted by our police department, and she wrote a lovely email to us. And then secondly, the Wheaton Police Department also sent a letter for thanking the Warrenville Police Department. So I'd like to thank them. We have no closed session. And we only need a motion to adjourn. We all want to stay here. A motion to adjourn?
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Motion passes. We are adjourned. Thank you.